Welcome to the Mobile Money Nation. My name is AJ, and today in this video, I wanted to talk about the difference between investing in stocks versus bonds. As a beginner investor, it's a really important distinction to know what these definitions are, and then also what it means as far as the differences in the types of gains that you can expect when you're investing in a stock versus investing into a bond. And these differences will also let you know which one may be considered a better investment. And so first we'll start off with the definition of a bond. A bond represents debt issued by either a company or a government, and that can be a local government like a city, a state, or it can be the federal government. And with this debt, the issuer is essentially borrowing money from investors to pay for specific necessary activities within their organization. And as for payment for allowing this company or this government entity to borrow money from you, they promise to pay you interest, which is called a coupon. And with this coupon, they also set a specific date, a maturity date, of when they expect to actually pay you back the initial principal that you issued to that company or government. Now, if you hold your bond until the maturity date, the value of the bond does not increase. However, if you do buy that bond in the open market, then the value of that bond can increase or decrease over time. Typically, the value of a bond will increase or decrease over time in line with the change in interest rates. So as the Federal Reserve decides to increase or decrease interest rates, the value of the bond will increase or decrease in value, which also changes the yield of the coupon you'll receive. So for example, if you have a $100 bond and it has a 5% coupon or yield for its interest, if the value of that bond were to increase because interest rates are declining, then the yield or the percent in comparison to the value of the total bond would decrease as well. However, as interest rates increase, then the value of that bond may lower in price, which increases the yield of that bond. Now, the reason for this is because if interest rates are higher, that means you can get interest rates for a savings account or maybe even a checking account at a higher rate. And so it's not worth it to lock your money into a bond for a specific 1, 5, 10, or maybe even 30-year period, which is the type of length that you can get when you're purchasing a bond. Next, we're going to talk about the definition of stocks. But before we do that, make sure you hit the subscribe button so you can get more videos just like this to learn more about the basics of investing. And I also do reviews of different investment platforms on my page as well. When you're purchasing a stock, you are purchasing ownership into a specific company. You're becoming a shareholder. That's why they call the individual pieces of the company you buy, they also refer to them as shares in addition to referring to them as stock. And so when you purchase a stock, you're becoming a shareholder. You are holding shares of a company. So as the value of that company increases or decreases in value, whether it's perceived value or the actual value of the company, then the value of the stock or the shares that you own will also increase or decrease in value. And those individual companies can decide whether or not they would like to pay a dividend to the owners of their shares. And so in addition to the increase or the decrease in the value of the company over time, you can also receive a payment direct from that company if they decide to pay a dividend. And typically dividends are paid quarterly, but they can also be paid monthly or annually. And the payments for those dividends are referred to as a yield. And so as an example, if you owned a stock that cost $100 and they paid a $2 dividend, then you would have a 2% yield. And that's based on the annual dividend. So if they paid quarterly, that $2 would be split up by 4 equal payments of 50 cents every quarter. And so now that you have the basic definition of what a bond is and what a stock is, then the next question is, which one is a better investment? And this is a typical question that many beginner investors may ask when they're deciding, you know, what they should invest in. And in order to answer that question, you have to first ask yourself, what is your risk tolerance and what is your overall plan or strategy as far as investing your money into the market? Do you want to invest your money and have the greatest potential for long-term growth? Or do you want to invest your money with the least likelihood that you'll lose money while also almost guaranteeing a specific payment back for the amount of money that you invested? And so generally speaking, if you're looking for the greatest potential for long-term growth, then you would invest your money into a stock or into an ETF that holds a large group of stocks. If you're looking to preserve your principal or to guarantee a specific payment over a specific amount of time, then you would want to invest your money into bonds. And so when you're speaking about a period of 10, 20, or maybe even 30 years, investing your money into stocks would be the best way to increase the value of the money you invested over that longer term period. And because the greatest difference between a bond and a stock is the fact that you are allowing someone to borrow money when you buy a bond versus when you're buying a stock, you are investing in the future growth of that business. And so I'll give you three examples. One example is investing into a bond for $100 and that bond pays a 5% yield. Versus two examples of one investing into a stock or an ETF that gives you a 2% dividend and also grows at the average annual rate of 8%. And also another stock that also pays a 2% dividend, but their average gain over the course of 10 years is 20% annually. And so while the bond is going to pay you 5% annually versus the two stock examples that I'm going to give that are only going to pay you 2% annually, you will see how you could potentially earn more money with the stock than you would investing in the higher yield bond. And so like I mentioned with a bond, the principal that you invest, that $100, that will not increase over time. So the only gains that you will receive is the 5% that you would gain from the actual bond every year. However, with the stock, you have the chance that that $100 could either increase or decrease in value. And over the history of the stock market, stocks have gained about 8% per year over an average annual basis. And so if you were to get that average gain while investing $100 over the course of 10 years, over this 10-year period, your $100 would actually grow to about $220 over that 10-year period. However, if you were to get a great return of, let's say, 20% per year over that same 10-year period, then your $100 would grow to about $740 in that 10-year period. Now, with both of these examples, we are not counting the 2% dividend that you would also gain over that time, or counting reinvesting those dividends into that same stock. And so even without reinvesting your dividends, with that 8% example, you would have gained another $20 in cash just from that 2% dividend, assuming that they never cut their dividend and you never reinvested those dividends into the stock. And so that would bring your total with that 8% average gain in the market to $240. And with the total for the 20% average gain in the market, that would bring your total gain to about $760 over that same time period. So over that same time period, your $100 bond would have only gained $50 from the coupon, that 5% yield that you're receiving from the company or from the government. And that would only be added back to the $100 that over the maturity period of that 10 years, you'd only receive that $100 back. So your total over that period would be $150. And so this is how you can see that investing in stocks, if you're looking for the most growth that you can get over a 10-year period or longer, then stocks are the obvious best choice to choose. However, you do have the risk that over that 10-year period, you could lose all or some of your money if you were to invest in a single company and that company were to go bankrupt over that 10-year period. However, if you were to invest that $100, either by investing into more than one stock or investing into an ETF that holds hundreds or thousands of stocks, you reduce your risk by spreading your money out into multiple individual companies. And so the great thing is that you don't have to choose one option. If you want to, you can invest 100% into stocks, and that will give you the max possible gain that you can get in the stock market. Or you can invest some of that into bonds as well, which will help reduce the risk of your overall investment portfolio. And so if you're younger and you have many years or potential years that you can invest in the market, then you can either invest 100% of your money into stocks or a percentage close to 100 if you have a long period where you can actually invest more money in the market and you have the time to gain back if there are any losses in your portfolio. However, if you're older and you're getting closer to retirement, you may want to reduce the amount of money that you put into stocks versus bonds. Some people may recommend a 60-40 split or maybe even higher than 40% in bonds. That way you can preserve more of your investment just in case there is a drop in the stock market like what we're experiencing right now in 2020. So as an example, I did create a portfolio, a Roth IRA, where I invest in both stocks as well as bonds. And this portfolio includes four ETFs, three of which are stocks and one is a bond ETF. And I have it set at a 95% stock investment split between the total stock market, the S&P 500, and an international stock ETF. And then the fourth investment is the bond, which is only 5% of the portfolio, but it invests in bonds within the United States. And so each month I provide an update via my Instagram. So if you'd like to follow that, you can follow me on Instagram or also follow my Facebook page to receive those updates. And if you would like to follow along and actually invest as well in this same portfolio, make sure you use the link in my description. I actually use the M1 Finance platform to create a Roth IRA. In order to open a Roth IRA with M1 Finance, you do need to start off with at least $500. But after you have that initial $500 investment, you can invest as little as $10 every time you want to add money to that portfolio. And in this specific portfolio, I started off last year in 2019 by investing $50 per month, in addition to that initial $500 I deposited into the account. And then in 2020, I started to deposit $100 each month to increase those investments. And so if you would like to follow along and also use M1 Finance as your Roth IRA, so just use that referral link that I've provided in the description as well as in the comment section below. All right, thanks for taking the time out of your day to watch this video. I really appreciate that. If you're not a current member of the Mobile Money Nation, all you have to do is hit the subscribe button down below. Hit the like button because you really like this video. And also hit the notification bell so you'll be notified the next time I create a video. Again, thanks for watching. Have a great day.